of the membership. And obviously the membership is why we're here this evening. So next slide, please. Okay, one moment here. Yeah, so as we all know, there's so many benefits to you know, having the membership for SPE, and the benefits that we can get from that and that most of you already received. Again, is the SPE online education and the Connect. And of course, just events like we're experiencing right now this evening and that. And because some of the additional benefits of those memberships is the volunteering opportunities, is the exposure that you have yourself within the industry, also becoming a coach to others and so on. But definitely we want to encourage everybody to get started, get connected, get informed, and get involved. And that's what's going to definitely excel yourself also in your career. But I think it's also the sharing of knowledge in the industry, especially right now, the times that we are in right now with the industry itself. So next slide, please. Yeah, so joining is fairly easy. As you know, for students, obviously, it's there is a sponsor company, Chevron, who offers that membership for free to students. We're just informed that upon your first year of graduation, you are still eligible for 1 year of free membership. There are some that have discussed or talked about having a little difficulties of making payments or transfers or so on. If you would, you could reach out to myself or to Jacksonada, and we could actually help and guide you. There's also links that are located on YouTube or on the SP website directly that will give you, step-by-step directions, whether that is for registration or for renewal. But please do reach out and contact if you feel that you have difficulties due to payment issues of credit card and looking for options. Do reach out to us and we'd be happy to guide you there. So next, please. Yeah, and so that concludes my portion. And again, I really appreciate everybody's, keeping that membership up to date so we can have more forums like this and other events. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Tony, for the presentation about the membership of SPE Jaffa Indonesia. Now we will call our beloved moderator. Hello, Mr. Hello. Tunggul.
Okay, hello, Mr. Revan, Mas Revan.
Okay, nice. How are you?
I'm fine, good. And you? Hi.
Okay, I'm really fine. Okay, Mr. Tunggul, place is yours, please.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Revan, for the time. Hello everyone, my name is Tunggul Mirza Pratama, or you can call me Tunggul. I'm currently a final year student of Geological Engineering Department at Pertamina University. First of all, I would like to say thanks to SPE Jaffa for giving me the amazing opportunity as the moderator of this webinar tonight. I hope we are doing well and stay healthy, as we know that in this pandemic, a lot of people have some problems in health itself, and surely I hope that we and our family are always in a good condition. Before we start our main event, I would like to introduce the simple rules of this event tonight. The first one is please stay mute during the presentation. And then if you have any question, you can directly deliver your question to our speaker using raise hand feature on your Zoom. Then I will call your name at Q&A session. Or you can also write down your question on the chat box. So I will read your question and your question will be answered by our speaker at Q&A session. Okay, and be prepared on turn on your camera. Okay, next slide, please. Then, this is our special speaker tonight. Her name is Vini Nandi Rahma. We can call her Vini. She is a final year student of Petroleum Engineering Department at Pertamina University, interested in reservoir engineering and modeling. Also, she has several achievements, including the first winner of International Plan of Development or POD competition at OGIP, Oil and Gas Intellectual Prize at 2020. also the first winner of Taekwondo Kyorugi Universitas Rastia Mulia 2018. So basically she also a strong woman, right? Yeah. And okay, next slide please. Then okay, I will give you a brief information of the main discussion tonight. The webinar will bring the interesting topic, absolutely, about reservoir geomechanics simulation with study case. As we know that the geomechanics is one of the ways we can learn more about the subsurface condition, especially reservoir in oil and gas industry. And the purpose of our discussion tonight is to know how hydrocarbon production and changes in rock characteristics affected the combination of geomechanics factors. So without waiting for so long, I will give it to our speaker now. So Vini, are you ready to present your research?
Okay, thank you, Tunggul. But before okay. I start, I want to make this my focus be enough. Okay, so is my voice clear enough?
Yes, yes, your voice is clear.
Okay, then pardon me because I want to share my screen first.
Okay.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, clearly seen in my
okay.
screen. Okay. Okay, Vini, the time is yours. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Tunggul, for the time and opportunity. My name is Vini Nandi Rahma. Currently, I am a final year student majoring in Petroleum Engineering of Universitas Utamina. In this occasion of member virtual talks at SP Java section, I'm going to share about what I know about 3D reservoir geomechanics simulation study case. Since I'm still also studying, please correct me if I'm wrong, and let's just make this session as a two-way discussion. So we are on to the outline. Okay, so this is the outline for today's sharing. First, we will start by introduction. Then I'm gonna explain a little bit about benefits of geomechanics modeling. The third one is about fully coupled method. The next is about study case. And the last one is conclusions. Okay, so let's start off with introduction to geomechanics. Okay, geomechanics is also known as the theoretical and applied science of the mechanical behavior of geological material. Geomechanics is also known as the study of how subsurface rock deform or fail in response to changes of stress, pressure, and temperature, and it is becoming increasingly important in oil and gas exploration. On the right side picture, it shows you an actual oil operation in North Sea. This picture shows the platform in Norway, which sank a few meters by the spring of 1985 with 40 until 50 centimeters sinking per year. And of course, that put a risk to the platform itself and also the people working in it. So what I'm trying to say is that geomechanical effect can be significant depending on the process and which field we are working. We also need to understand and make a modeling work to mitigate the risks. Conventionally, the reservoir engineers or other engineers has been using non-deformable reservoir, where the bulk volume stays constant while the bulk volume changes. When the bulk volume stays constant, that means the grid block stays in the same shape as the time goes by based on the simulation. We can see in the pictures left, it is a screen capture of the bulk volume changes of the sector model. But we also need to take notes that even though we are using non-deformable reservoir, we have actually considered geomechanics parameter into our model, such as rock compressibility, which ends up changing the pore volume of the rock based on the pressure. And then about deformable reservoir. Okay, so real geomechanical modeling means the model is considered as deformable reservoir where the pore volume changes, but the bulk volume also changes as the time goes by. On the right side is the example of a model which we can see the deformity of the model due to the formation subsidence and compaction due to the production activity. This is the deformation of the model. The source is from geomechanics technologies.
Okay. Sorry, Vini, for cutting your presentation, but can you share your screen because this another black box in your screen. Maybe you can share full screen, right?
How about this? Still see the black box?
Yeah, still, yeah.
I'm sorry, I don't think I really know how to avoid this black box.
Okay. Share all screen maybe. In share screen, you can choose share all.
Share all screen? Oh, but no.
There's still a black mark. I think it is better now. Maybe. Okay, you can continue your presentation.
Okay, now I will continue the presentation. I want to say sorry to all participants for the inconvenience. I think I cannot avoid the black box thingy. Okay, now I will continue to the benefits of geomechanical modeling. Okay, there are four phases of geomechanical role in life cycle of hydrocarbon reservoir. The first one is exploration and assessment phase of reservoir development, such as the example is like the prediction of pore pressure, hydrocarbon column heights, and also maybe fault seal or leakage potential. The second one is during the development phase where engineers seek to optimize wellbore stability through determination of optimal well trajectories, or maybe like casing set points and mud weights, and geologists attempt to predict permeability anisotropy in fracture reservoirs. The third one is on the production phase of the reservoir that requires selection of optimal completion methodologies, the prediction of changes in reservoir performance during depletion, and assessment of techniques such as like hydraulic fracturing to optimize the total recovery. And the last one is during the secondary and tertiary reservoir development. By the example is like by when we want to optimize processes such as using water flooding and steam injection. The reasons why we need geomechanical modeling can be divided into scales, which is well scale and full scale. One of the examples has been shown before where a platform sank. So on a well scale, it can help us answer questions about wellbore stability, sand production, and hydraulic fractures. On a field scale, it can help us answer about fault activation or reactivation, about subsidence or heave. The third one is maybe about cavern integrity, effect on reservoir flow, and history match for this assessment. Okay, I want to tell you that this is not all of the benefits on why we should consider geomechanics modeling. There might be other reasons of the benefits about geomechanics simulation. And then, why should we consider geomechanics in reservoir simulation? The first one is about in rock compressibility. In classical dynamic reservoir simulators, the geomechanics is approximated via changes in porosity and permeability induced by rock compressibility as a constant or pressure dependent. Regarding stress field during depletion and injection, the stress field can change resulting in various rock movements, compaction, induced fracturing, enhancement of natural fractures, and even fault activation. In direction, the rock movement has directions and it could affect permeabilities and fault transmissibility in addition to porosity changes. Hence, the scalar pressure dependent rock compressibility may not be enough. So the couple simulation can become essential to connect reservoir flow and in-situ stresses and also perform coupled simulation. Next, the next outline is about fully coupled geomechanical. Before we jump into this explanation about fully coupled, let me explain a little bit about the Let me explain a little bit about the basic theories. Okay, so stress is defined as force acting on the object per unit area. The equation is force divided by unit area. While strain is the quantity to describe an object that deforms under stress. And the equation for strain is differences between length after given force subtracted by original length and then divided by the original length. And then I'm going to explain a little bit about the Young's modulus and Poisson ratio. Young's modulus is an important parameter to define the relationship between stress and strain in a material in the linear elastic deformation. The equation is uniaxial stress divided by strain. Poisson ratio is the ratio of transverse strain to corresponding axial strain on a material stress along one axis. The equation is transversal strain divided by axial strain. Okay, so this is the this is the full system of equations that Tinefer Gerder used for fully coupled. Different simulator might use different equations, but overall the equations are like this. The source of these equations is from SPE Russian Petroleum Technology Conference in 2018. The equations included flow in porous media, and then mass conservation inside porous media, and then also Lamb's equation for linear elastic media, and also rock mass conservations. In this study case, I'm using Tinefer-Gerder as the simulator to do coupled simulation. Okay, now we are on the main sharing, which is the study case. Okay, so the upsector model is from Tuma field. The zone characteristics are carbonate reservoir Batu Ajaib M. The reservoir is have a heavy oil of 18 API, high viscosity of 20 centipoise, initial pressure of 1132 psi, and temperature of 155 Fahrenheit degree. So the sector model is from a Zuma field located in here, but then we cut the model to be in this box so that the model is only this section of the model, this section of the field. And then these are just the object statistics of the model details. In here, we can see the dimensions of the model, like the dimensions is 33 times 34 times 38. The total blocks are 42,636. And then the active blocks are around 35,454. And these are the horizons and faults. There are 5 horizons in this sector model, and also 12 horizons in this sector model. These are just the basic grid properties that are inputted to the simulator, and there are permeability along X, permeability along Y, permeability along Z, and also the porosity. For history matching, the geomechanics is turned off first, so we run the geomechanics coupling since the start of the simulation after the model has matched. Okay, so this is just the basic free properties that I imported to the simulator. There's free properties like pressure, raw compressibility, datum depth, datum pressure, water oil contact, gas oil contact, water density, oil density, gas density, and hydrocarbon temperature. And then these are just the wells data details that I imported to the simulator. There are perforation date and also perforation interval. The total of the wells are, there are 17 producing wells in this sector model. Okay, the parameters imported before we run the simulation are Young's modulus and Poisson ratio. After we input the geomechanics parameter, we compare the base model simulation results with geomechanics model simulation results. In this case, we run the model from 2021 until year 2041. So after we run the simulation with geomechanics, there are differences in production value, and the one affects the production are the changes in pressure, saturation water, volume, and kinetic humidity. In gym mechanics model, we can also see the gym mechanics property calculation results, such as maximal stress horizontal and displacement factor. And we can only see this maximal stress and displacement factor on the model that have been encoded with gym mechanics simulation. The gym mechanics parameter input is yang modulus the value of 1.48 MPSI and Poisson ratio of 0.37. These are the results of the simulation. We can see the pressure comparison. There is pressure differences in simulation with gym mechanics where it is 0.026 smaller than without gym mechanics. Production from hydrocarbon reservoir cause decreases in reservoir pressure. In simulation with gym mechanics parameter, the simulation consider rock properties and also rock deformation changes. And with those gym mechanics parameters, this subsector model simulation responded dynamically towards pore pressure changes by considering the geological boundary. Next is about saturation water comparison. So the saturation differences in simulation with gym mechanics is 0.02% bigger. The differences are caused by geological changes, just like the reservoir property before. Saturation water changes in production phase of the reservoir is inevitable because these changes are affected by the geological boundary too. In simulation with gym mechanics parameter, this sector model consider iteration from rock elasticity, from Poisson ratio and Young's modulus input, and this increases of saturation water value impacted in production decreases. Next is about the relative permeability of oil comparison. So generally, relative permeability of oil value in model with gym mechanics parameter is around 0.113% difference, smaller. These decreases of relative permeability of oil are impacted by stress changes that happens when production phase occur. In production phase, there is stress changes that resulted in pressure and temperature changes. That is why changes in rock properties such as porosity and permeability affect the reservoir performance. Okay, so besides those reservoir property that we compared before, we also compare the pore volume differences. Generally, pore volume in simulation with gym mechanics parameter are 0.1242% smaller. Just as reservoir property before, the simulation with gym mechanics parameter consider rock properties, changes, and also deformation changes. Rock deformation are also affecting the permeabilities and compressibilities of rock. That is why there are portfolio variation on the simulation. Okay, next is about the maximal stress horizontal, where we compare, where in this case, we can only see this distribution of maximal stress distribution on the model with gym mechanics simulation. On the right side, we can see the vector where the vector is focused on the well area. And while pore pressure decreasing at production phase, it also causes horizontal stress to decrease. Based on the picture, we can see how the stress decreases from year 2021 until 2041. Overall, the maximal stress differences from 2021 until 2041 is around 1.22% difference. Next is about the displacement factor. In this subsector model, it can be seen that the reservoir deformation is dominated by displacement near fault region, which is that QCHAT fault 2. The total displacement factor on year 2041 is around 1.1896 feet for overall grid blocks and 0.00004 feet for each grid block. Okay, so on the right side of this picture, we can also see the factor where the factor focuses on the fault region and also on the production well. And then we conducted a study case where we want to see the gene mechanics impact on the production changes. Simulation with gene mechanics resulted in production decreases. The oil production in gene mechanics simulation is 0.38% smaller, and in gas production is 2.5057% smaller. As the reservoir property before that, we can see the value is smaller than the black oil model or the compositional model. These differences are resulted by pressure depletion with gene mechanics parameter that considers rock elasticity that impacted to reservoir property differences. Okay, so next in the study case, I also did a gene mechanics parameter sensitivity analysis, where in this part, I changed the Poisson ratio value and also the Young's modulus value. The way I changed the Poisson ratio and Young modulus is, I wanna know what if I cut the Poisson ratio, I use smaller Poisson ratio, and what is the effect if I use bigger Poisson ratio, and also the same as Young modulus, I wanna see how it affect when we use Young modulus smaller and also Young modulus bigger. I wanna see how it affected the simulation result. Okay, so this is the result. In this sensitivity analysis, we want to know the impact on part volume changes. As we can see from the graphics, bigger Poisson ratio and Young's modulus resulted in smaller part volume value. This is because larger Poisson ratio value shows that the rock property is more elastic and stronger in resisting pressure. That is why the part volume becomes smaller. This also applies to Young modulus, where the bigger the Young modulus value is, then the material is more stiff, and that is why it is harder to do fracturing. Okay, so I also wanted to know the parameter sensitivity analysis effect on the oil cumulatives. Based on these graphic results on oil production, bigger Poisson ratio and Young modulus resulted in smaller oil production, where it is related with the smaller part volume value as the slide before. Okay, I think I'm getting too fast with the presentation, but we have been into the conclusions. Based on the study case, there are pressure differences between simulation with gene mechanics parameter and without gene mechanics parameter shows 0.036 smaller. There is also a difference in water saturation property around 0.02% bigger on simulation with gene mechanics property. Overall, relative permeability of oil value in simulation with gene mechanics parameter has smaller value of 0.0113%. Overall, in year 2021, this model has 10,714,000 PSI of maximal stress horizontal. The reservoir deformation is dominated by the displacement near fault region, which is ZQCED fault 2. The total displacement factor on year 2041 is 1.19 feet for all grid blocks. Oil production cumulatives in simulation with gene mechanics resulted in smaller value of 0.38% than simulation without gene mechanics, and 2.5057% smaller in gas production cumulatives. And as we have conducted the sensitivity analysis before, smaller Poisson ratio and Young's modulus resulted in bigger pore volume. And also, it also applies to oil production changes, where if we use smaller Poisson ratio and also Young's modulus, it resulted in higher oil production. So this is the suggestion about the 3D reservoir gene mechanics simulation. The first one is, for higher utilization of gene mechanics on simulation, it is advised to do development scenario by considering gene mechanical aspect, because good reservoir management may require a gene mechanics component to optimize well performance and also the reservoir development. We should also input more gene mechanics parameter besides Young's modulus and also Poisson ratio, which is Biot coefficient to observe the pore pressure and also an effective stress when the solid and fluid and condor deformation independent. Lastly, these are the references that I used on the research. And also, thank you for the time. I want to acknowledge my academic supervisor first. Thank you for Sergeir Sorim Chandra Cerdasa for teaching me about gene mechanics modeling, especially about 3D reservoir gene mechanics simulation. I want to say thank you and sorry for all participants if I explain it too fast or not detailed enough. Thank you for the opportunity and time given. Now I will give it back to moderator to do the questions.
Okay, thank you, Vinny, for your interesting presentation. Now we are at the Q&A session. To all participants, if you have any question, you can directly deliver your question to our speaker using the raise hand feature on your Zoom, or you can also write down your question on the chat box. So I will read your question, and your question will be answered by our speaker. Now, for the first question is coming from Euphoria Hani first, but he is raised his hand. Maybe you can turn on your microphone, Hani. Euphoria Hani, are you there? Oh, I can open it. Okay, I will read your question. So, how many types of coupled simulation and what type of coupled simulation that you use? So that's all the question.
Okay, so about coupled simulations, there are actually many different types of ways on how to do coupled simulation. The first one is classical approach, which to model pore volume changes induced by compressibility. And then there is also extended classical when the raw compressibility is pressure dependent. And then about the other types of coupled simulations. The first trial in coupled simulation can be done in one-way coupling, one-way coupling where the pressure is feed into another engine to get stress and displacement. Then there is also loose or leapfrog, where it is the most typical coupling in industry, which is the geomechanical engine. Then the geomechanical engine calculates porosity and sends the porosity back to the reservoir simulator. And then the reservoir simulator will do restarting simulation. So it's like that type of coupling simulation is like going back and forth that requires two simulators. And the last one is polycoupled, which can be used in simulator where we just need one simulator. So if the question is about what coupled simulation that you use, I use polycoupled simulation in the navigator simulator. Thank you, Euphoria Hani. I hope that can answer.
Okay, thank you for the question, Vini. Maybe there's a some question, same question from Hendrik van der Werf. Which commercial simulation tool did you use for your coupled simulation study?
I'm sorry, can you please repeat the question?
Which commercial simulation tool did you use for your coupled simulation study?
Oh, so the simulator that I use is Navigator. Together, I use designer model, and also I use simulation results. Where in this designer model, I can choose when I wanna turn on the gene mechanics simulation or not. So yeah, I use Navigator simulator. It is very comfortable for me to use Navigator than any other simulator, like maybe CNG or Petrel, because as far as I know, Petrel use two simulator, which is Eclipse, and also we should have Visage simulator. And since I don't really have the Visage simulator, I don't use Petrel. And before that, I also have tried to use CMG or computer modeling simulator, where in CMG I encounter several problems, and the iteration took too long for my model. That is why I use it. myself that can answer the question.
Okay, thank you, Vini, for the answer. And maybe we move to the Mr. Rico Rizkia Putra question. Yes, he has two questions. The first one is, did you perform calibration with the ROC test, triaxial test, and or uniaxial volume compressibility test?
Okay, did I perform calibration with ROC test, triaxial test, and uniaxial volume compressibility test? The answer is, I don't really perform that because I only get the end of the results back. The person that do those calculation give me the last parameters, which is Poisson ratio and growth. Okay, so in TV together, what we really need to input to our simulator that is very mandatory to do coupled simulation is Poisson ratio and Young modulus. Of course, we can also add more generalized parameter to be more reliable, to have more reliable results. But I only need those two, so I didn't really perform that. But people before me has also done that to calculate Poisson ratio and Young modulus.
Okay, hope that answered your question. And then he asked also the second question is, did you see any major production difference between conventional simulation and coupled simulation with geomechanics?
I don't really see any major production difference between conventional simulation and coupled simulation with geomechanics. Because the thing is, when we apply geomechanics simulation, we shouldn't have really have that much difference. Because if we have that much of differences, then there might be something wrong with our coupled simulation. Like, for staying in safe, I'm just gonna stuck it like it shouldn't be more than 3%. So, did you see any major production difference between conventional simulation? So no. So if we encounter like in coupled simulation, we see the results, the production changes very much, like 10% or 20% or maybe even 50% or bigger, then we should look at our simulation more. We should find where is the problem, and we should kind of solve the problem. Because yeah, it shouldn't really affect the simulation. Because what the simulators do is just simulate just like usual conventional simulation, but the simulator consider iteration with the mechanics equation.
Okay, thank you there for the answer, Vini. And now we move to the person who raised his hand. The first one is Mr. Ade Surya. You can turn on your microphone, or maybe you can turn on your video.
Hello, can you hear my voice?
Yes, clearly.
Okay, a very good presentation, Vini.
Thank you, sir.
I have several questions actually, but we'll keep it like three questions. So for my first question is, I can see in your slide you have a portfolio map.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, how do you calibrate those portfolio map? And how do you get it? That's my first question. Let me finish my question first. And the second question is about, I'm still confused with your concept of the fully coupled geomechanics. So basically, you're using a T-navigator, right? And then T-navigator is the geomechanic simulator, or T-navigator is a dynamic simulator?
It's okay. Maybe I will answer the first question, but the portfolio.
Yeah. Okay, you can answer that one. Sure.
Okay. So how to calibrate my portfolio? I don't really do that, but it's just that when I turn on geomechanics simulation on T-navigator, in the results, I can see the pore volume changes. Like, and it is only when I apply it to the model with geomechanics simulation. So yeah, I can see the pore volume from that running simulation results. And then the question is, about what simulator did I use. I used the Navigator simulator, where in this simulator, there are actually various things in that, like other simulator, like there is a basic geological model design, there is a designer, there is a model designer, there's also a history matching designers, it's also like, there's also a tab where we can see the simulation results. And if the question is about how do I do geomechanics simulation, instead, I turn on the geomechanics simulation after I do the history matching first. So there's like this little tab in the model designer that I can turn on, and then the simulation will be turned on to the coupled simulations.
Okay, so still I still confused on this question number two, but let me clarify this. Make it simple. This is question number two. You have T-Navigator, right? Yes, your machine is T-Navigator, right? And then in those machines, you have a dynamic model run in that one, right? Yeah. Is the T-Navigator is also can run and generate the stress modeling inside?
Yeah, we can also see the stress in T-Navigator.
The T-Navigator can generate stress model. Okay, so it means that you couple it using only one machine, T-Navigator, to couple a dynamic model from T-Navigator and also to generate a stresses model from T-Navigator itself.
Yes, that is true.
And then you only use Poisson ratio and Young's modulus as input.
Yeah, well, geomechanics, the only mandatory parameters to do geomechanics simulation is only Poisson ratio and Young's modulus.
All right, so this is my last question. Is the rock properties, Young's modulus, Poisson ratio, is it changed by the time or it will constant by the time?
In this study case, I use it as a constant value, where this constant value of Poisson ratio and Young's modulus has been adjusted to the reservoir characteristics. So the people that has been doing the 1D geomechanical modeling send it to me the final value of Poisson ratio that suited with the model.
So it means that the rock properties is changing by the lithology, not the time, you mean?
Yeah, that is true.
So back to my question, is the rock properties is changed by the time or not? By time means, for example, we have a pre-production condition now, and then probably 15 years later, is the rock properties is changed or not?
Yes, the rock properties changes, and that is why we can see the changes in reservoir property, like pressure, permeability, porosity, and also saturation water. The difference results, it changed because the rock properties, including rock elasticity and deformation, changes. So it also depends on the rock changes, rock behavior changes.
Okay. All right. So I think that's all from my side. Thank you. Thank you very much, Vini. Thank you, Mas Tunggul.
Okay. Thank you, Vini, for the amazing answer, right? And thank you, Mr. Adi, for the interesting question. So now we move to the Lutfi Laili Awati. The question is, what are role of geomechanics in production phase? I think this is a general question. So what do you think, Vini, about the role of geomechanics in production phase?
Okay, so there are many of geomechanics production. I mean, there are roles in production phases of geomechanics application. The first one, maybe we can use geomechanics for flow assurance analysis, or maybe wellbore integrity, and then also we can apply geomechanics to analysis about mitigate surface problem. We can also consider geomechanics to monitor rock and fluid interaction at the production phases and something like that. So in production phases, geomechanics can play a lot to that phases too, to the production phases too. Does that answer my question? Yeah.
Okay, Lutfi. Okay, maybe that's the answer from Vini. Thank you, Vini. Now We'll move to Ajeng Hamida. She raised her hand. So Ajeng, can you open your mic and maybe okay. Open your cam, maybe?
Okay. Can you hear my voice?
Yes, clearly.
Okay. Thank you, Tonggul, for the opportunity, and thank you, Vinny, for the great presentation. My name is Ajeng Rito Hamida. I want to ask you a question. We know that geomechanics give us impact for the reservoir development. So what are the roles of geomechanics in creating the reservoir? Thanks in advance.
So the question is, what are the roles in creating the reservoir? I mean, what are the geomechanics role in creating the reservoir phase itself, right?
Yes, right.
Okay, so back again. Role of geomechanics in creating reservoir is the first one is back to the drilling site, like well planning, completion design, stimulation design. And then on that phase of creating the reservoir, geomechanics can do analysis about the stress and strain more to get geomechanics parameters such as Poisson ratio and Young's modulus to be imputed to our model. So we can see that geomechanics can give impact in development of reservoir. I think that might answer the questions.
Okay. Do you have any extra questions, Ajeng? Or maybe that's enough?
Okay, that's enough. Thank you, Vinny and Tunggu.
Okay, thank you, Ajeng, for the question and Vinny for the answer. So now we are moving on the Caroline Putri. She asked about the on drilling side. How can we apply geomechanics modeling to the hydrocarbon reservoir life cycle?
In the drilling site, there has been so many research where the driller consider geomechanics analysis, such as drilling design, instability issues, casing setting depth also, like pore pressure predictions, completion designs, or maybe like hydraulic fracturing, action and subsidence. And I mean, so during the drilling process, the pre-existing stress will be redistributed around the wellbore to which the stress will be concentrated in the rock. In case the stress concentration is too large for the rock to manage, then the rock around will fail. That is the first concept. And then in drilling geomechanics example, when the stress concentrations around the wellbore can be reduced depending on the hydrostatic pressure, we can design what mud weight should we use while drilling the wellbore. So I think that is one of the example where we can design mud weight based on the geomechanics analysis to make our analysis to be more reliable. Yeah, I think that is for the
okay. Thing. Okay, now we move to the Mr. Rio. He asked about, is there any constraint for which type of reservoir to get optimal use for the geomechanics modeling?
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question?
Is there any constraint for which type of reservoir to get optimal use for the geomechanics modeling?
Is there any constraint for which type of reservoir to get optimal use of the geomechanics modeling? Okay, so for geomechanics modeling, we can use every model like black oil or compositional model. So what I'm trying to say is that we can apply geomechanics to any model. So there might be no constraint which type of reservoir to get. Anything that any model that use geomechanics is fine, like. Because our first aim to do modeling is to make the model as real as possible, as real as the subsurface condition as possible. And what by considering geomechanics simulation, then we can turn the model to be more real. Yeah, so to make it short, there is no constraint for which type of reservoir. We can use any type of reservoir for
Okay, thank you for the answer. And now, if to all participants, if you have any question, you can directly ask the your question to the speaker by using the raise hand feature on your Zoom, or maybe you can write down your question on chat box. And so I will read your question, and the speaker will, and your question will be answered by the speaker. Now, while we are waiting for other question come from the participants, maybe I want to ask you, Vinny, about what is your most challenging part while you are working on this research? Can you tell us the story, maybe either in technical or non-technical way?
Okay, so the challenges that I encountered while doing the geomagnetic simulation, is that right? Yeah, okay. My most challenging part while I'm working on this research, which is geomagnetic simulation, started with preparing the model. What I mean about preparing the model is also to do history matching. Like, since the model is a, in this study case, the model is a carbonate reservoir, and we all know that carbonate is a very complex reservoir, whether it is like the porosity or permeability distribution. Like in carbonate reservoir, there might be low porosity, but the reservoir has a high permeability. And since the model has its own complexity, I'm the one who have to adjust to it. Like, I have to do trial and error to make sure the model has matched. And then the challenges is, after the model has matched, then I did the couple simulation, but the preparation was challenging enough. Like, first we have to input the geomagnetic parameter and then we run it. But the thing is, in my case, running with geomagnetic parameter just doesn't go that smoothly. Like, the running can stuck at any moment. It could be at after 20% of running, 50% of running, or even 99% of running, the simulation will encounter problem. And then, of course, as the person who is behind the software, who's behind the simulator, we are the one who should adjust with the tool. I took a long time doing trial and error. Like, when we get stuck, we should know what is the problem behind it and try to solve it. One of the things that I learned about the couple simulation is that it takes longer time to run when we want to compare it with model with a geomechanics like black oil or compositional. It took longer time because the geomechanics parameter are considered in the simulation iteration. And yeah, I also took a lot of time using other simulator too other than T-Navigator. But at the end of the day, I choose to use T-Navigator because it is just more comfortable for me. I think that is the challenges that I encountered.
Okay, I think it's a very, very complex challenge, I think, yeah. So maybe, okay, what? Okay, sorry. Okay, maybe I want to ask another question. As you know, every subsurface model has their own uncertainties, yeah? So can you explain what are the uncertainties maybe in your model?
Uncertainties, like what? Maybe can you give me the example?
Maybe like, what's the name? If we want to make a porosity distribution, but we just have two wells that it can make the porosity distribution is not 100% correct like that. Data limitation maybe.
Limitation. So
yeah.
The question is a little bit same like the previous questions. So maybe I will make it like an example like. I'm gonna compare if I do geomagnetic simulation in carbonate reservoir and also sandstone reservoir. Since those rocks has different characteristics and formula, of course the outcome results of geomagnetics will give different response. As far as we all know, carbon net is very complex, just like what you have said. So the limitation is that maybe the carbon net has more random positive distribution than sensing reservoir. So that is what may be encountered during the simulations. In my opinion, doing geometric modeling is like giving a point plus to our research to be more reliable, since geomechanics consider the rock elasticity and deformity, or in short, the geomechanics consider the rock behavior. And just as what I've said before, it all depends on the first objectives on why we want to do geomechanics modeling at the first place. Now we go back to the comparison if we do geomechanics simulation to the carbonate reservoir. We all know that carbonate is more stiff than sandstone, is that right? And then it also has higher, more stiff material, then it has higher Poisson ratio and also Young modulus, which lead to smaller pore volume. In the end, it affects the fluid flow from subsurface to production well. While doing geomechanics simulations, different reservoir will have different challenges. But at the end of the day, the outcome result is very worth it. What we need to take notes in 3D reservoir geomechanics simulation is when we compare the reservoir property and production with the base model, there shouldn't be that much of a difference, because if it is too much, then there might be something wrong in what we input, and we should solve the problem again. I hope that can answer the question.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Maybe I want to ask last question. Maybe if there is no question again, maybe you can. You already mentioned about default. So I want to ask about the, as we see that default is also influence the models. So if we want to conduct a geomechanics simulation, so do we do default standard or maybe we just using the assumptions, just like that.
Okay, so before that, your answer is, should we do fault seal analysis first to know like the characteristics of fault?
Yeah, like this.
Okay, so maybe before I answer too far from that, we might want to take back to the start on why we want to do geomechanics modeling or simulation at the first place. The objectives on why we want to do geomechanical modeling can be divided into two scales, and those are well scale and also field scale. If we want to do the characteristic of fault, whether it be sealing or leaking, then the answer is yes. We should do fault seal analysis first to our model. In that case, after we do fault seal analysis, then we might want to do 1D and 3D modeling to support our research, whether there might be fault activations. But actually, in 3D model, we can actually still do carpet simulation where we consider geometric parameter to our model in a very simple model where there is no fault. At the end of the day, it all depends on what is our main objectives on why we want to conduct geomechanics simulation at the first place. We should also remember that one of our goals to make 3D reservoir model is to make a model as similar as the subsurface condition as possible. So in my opinion, more complex reservoir model with validations has more accurate and reliable simulation results, whether we want to do field development and like that. So yeah, should we do fault seal analysis first? My recommendation is yes. So our analysis will be more reliable.
Okay. Thank you very much, Vinny. Due to there is no question, and I think that I think that's more than enough for tonight. I think because there is a lot of lesson we get together. Surely. So I have to close this webinar. And if you want to ask more about this topic, maybe you can contact Vinny through LinkedIn. Maybe. Her LinkedIn name is same like her name, Vinny Nandirahma. Okay, thank you so much, Vinny, for the awesome sharing tonight. And thank you, SPE Java Session, for having me as a moderator. And thank you to all participants that attend this event tonight. And don't forget to follow SPE social media at Instagram and LinkedIn for the next event information. Okay, that's all from me. And I will give it back to Mr. Revan. And Mr. Revan, the time is yours.
Okay, thank you, Tunggal. Well, exactly. Thank you for the advertisement also in our social media. I think we learned a lot tonight, right, guys? So, but I want to remind you, please do not leave this room right now because we will share the evaluation form if you want to receive the certificate for participate this event. Right now, let us forward to the next agenda. For the appreciation moment, I would like to invite Mr. Yusuf to say something for our moderator and our speaker. Hello, Mr. Yusuf.
Hello, good evening, everyone. Thank you, Mas Refandi, for the invitation. Well, I'd like to say thank you very much for Ms. Vini and Mas Tunggul for the brave presentation and good session tonight. I think it was a very good practice actually for us to provide a platform for our members to share their experiences and expertise to each other. And I hope that it can encourage all of us, other SB members, to share our experience to each other, to other SB members and non-members, so that we can improve our knowledge together. Well, I should admit that it was a good presentation, Ms. Vini, knowing that you are still a student, last year student, seventh semester, if I'm not mistaken. But I think the quality that you did and you present to us is very good. So we really appreciate that, and I hope you success in the next in the near future for your career after your graduation. So maybe we can continue to the appreciation ceremony, Mr. Fandi, please.
Okay, please, next speaker.
Yeah, I'll give this certificate of appreciation to you, Ms. Vini Nandi Rahma. Thank you for your participation in this member virtual talks. Thank you very much. So, Mr. Refandi, should we take a picture or what?
Yes, of course. The documentation team. Wait. Okay. Let's take a picture together. 1, 2, 3. Okay. Maybe Vini want to say something.
Okay, so of course I want to say a very thank you to the committee of SP Java Indonesia sections, where in this occasion I can share a bit about my thesis. So actually I'm on my 8th semester of college. I really, really want to say thank you for all the opportunity. I also want to say sorry if maybe the presentation is too fast or maybe it is not clear enough. I'm going to try my best. Thank you.
Good job. Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Vini. It was great. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Vini. Now we continue to our beloved moderator, Mr. Yusuf.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mas Tunggul, Mirza Pratama, for arranging this session. I think it went very smooth. Thank you very much for your participation. I hope you success in the near future, and I hope to see you again in next SB Java event. Well, by this, I give the certificate of appreciation to you, Mas Tunggul. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Yusuf, Mr. Vini, and Mr. Tunggul and Mbak Vini for the moment. Now we continue to our last event. We will take a picture together, but first I want to remind you about to fill our form in the link that you can see in the screen, or you can see in the chat box. Please fill it if you want a certificate to get. Now we will take a picture together. So please, participant, you can turn on your camera right now. Please give us your handsome or beautiful face. Okay. Dika, can you help me to have a documentation
Okay, for the slide one. One, two, three. Okay, wait. For the slide two, one, two, three. Okay, it's done.
Okay, thank you, Dika. Maybe that's all from us, but I want to remind you, this event is open to all member of SPE. So if you are a SPE member and you want to share about knowledge, if you are a student like Vini, like Tunggul, it's okay. You can share anything with us and you can fill the form in the screen you can see. And please let us know if you are and have any question to me, Raifan and Dika. And maybe that's all from me. Thank you everyone for attending Series 1 Member Virtual Talks. Thank you. Don't forget to follow our social media in Instagram and in LinkedIn and YouTube. Bye, see you all.
See you, thank you. Thank you, SPE.
Thank you,
Mas Revan, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Tunggul. Thank you, Vini.
Thank you.